Salutations, Celestial Sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Well, we are looking south, and summer, the beginning of summer at least, has passed, but we are still in kind of that phase where we're not going to get as much darkness as we'd like because it still stays light for a long time. If we back up here to even 8:30, we can see that we're just barely seeing Saturn and Mars and Antares. And still have a lot of light sky. If we fast forward to an hour ahead, those stars and planets are popping up much more obviously, but it really takes at least that late at night to be able to see things, unlike in the winter where we can see things at like 5:30, 6:30 at night. So looking south, we've got our planet trio along with the bright star Antares in Scorpio, and over just to the east of that is Sagittarius. And I'll bring up the constellation line so you can kind of see that. Here's Scorpius, where it's got kind of the body shape, and then the tail that comes over to this star, Shaula, which is actually going to be an important star for us to remember later on, even though we're going to do a lot of our jumping off from Sagittarius over here, which is the teapot shape. And the neat thing about the teapot is that you can see kind of the handle here. Here's the body of it. Here's the lid. Here's the spout. Just off the spout area, and where the steam would be coming out of the teapot, this area right here, that's pretty much the center of our Milky Way galaxy, right in that area. You're looking right into the heart of where everything revolves around from a gravitational standpoint. That's where the massive black hole is at the center of our galaxy, and all the stars and planets and dust and everything else goes around that point. You can't actually see the black hole, but you can at least be looking in that direction. But what we're going to look for is two open clusters right in that area, Messier 6 and Messier 7. These are some really great open clusters, one of which you're really going to need to be probably binoculars to use, and the other one you could probably do in a wide field telescope okay at low power. But they're really easy to find, and they're great objects to see. Obviously, they're low on Messier's list, so they were ones that he found fairly quickly. So if we pull up our DSOs a little bit, we can see one of these is actually called the Butterfly Cluster. The other one is listed as M7. So we're going to start actually with the Butterfly Cluster, Messier 6. And the way that I find this is if we kind of zoom in on this area, we can see here's the teapot shape. And what we would want to do is if we're looking with our finder scope, we're going to kind of, actually, let me back off a little bit of these deep sky objects so we don't get too confused, so we kind of know where we're looking. So here's the Butterfly Cluster over here. We're going to start at this star, which is the spout of the teapot, Alnassel. We're going to go from Caos Media, which is the middle star of kind of the bow shape, but we call it the teapot because it kind of looks like a teapot to us. Follow these stars kind of in the direction that they're going, and you'll drop down just a little bit. But if we even go in that direction, kind of like this, I see we follow that line pretty well, we're just going to have Messier 6 in our field of view. But then this star right here comes out. So we know we're going to kind of go out, but then drop just a little bit to this one. This is a fifth magnitude star, so it's going to be brighter than a lot of the stars in the immediate area. This is, you know, ninth magnitude, that's seventh magnitude, this one is seventh magnitude. So the fifth magnitude stars should pop out fairly well. Alnassel is going to be around second magnitude, so you're going to have a drop off. But that's the direction that you're going to kind of want to go. It makes a nice straight line right over to, boom, the Butterfly Cluster. This is a 4.2 magnitude cluster with a surface brightness of 9.92. If we zoom in on the Butterfly Cluster, this is about a 1 degree field of view, so a low power view. I'll take off the crosshairs. You can see that we kind of have this butterfly shape here, sort of the body. We have some stars that swing out this way, another bunch of stars that swing out this way. And you can even see the antenna. This is kind of the upside down shape. But it really does sort of look like a butterfly shape. It's a neat cluster to take a look at. 1 degree or so, so low power is going to frame that nicely. The thing to keep in mind as we back out of this is you'll notice that all of both of these clusters are going to be low. We're looking straight south right when these are on the meridian. So when we bring up our azimuth grid, we can see that where my latitude is at about 40 degrees north latitude, Messier 6 is really only going to be about 17, 18, maybe, probably not even 18 degrees up. So you really have sort of this short window where you're going to be able to have it. I mean, if we go an hour ahead, we're, you know, back down close to 15 degrees. If we go to 11:30, we're down at 12 degrees. So you really want to look at it while it's at or near this meridian line, which for me is going to be around 9:30 in the evening. So 9:30, 10 o'clock, 10:30, those are kind of your prime viewing windows to be able to see these. So about an hour, hour and a half, or 2 hours after sunset is a good time to look for these right now in the next week, two, or three. So for Messier 7, to find that, because that's even lower in the sky, of course, you're obviously going to need a very clear horizon to see these. If we take these back off, now we're going to start at Shaula, which is our bright star that's the stinger of the Scorpion. And you can kind of look towards Caos Australis. So Caos Media was here. Caos Borealis was here. These are kind of the bow. And this was Alnaso that we jumped off from for Messier 6. If we go to Caos Australis, which is the bottom star of the teapot on the side where the spout is, and Shaula, we've got this really low, wide, flat triangle that we can make. There's actually two ways to do this. We can either use Caos Australis, which is a little farther away because from Shaula to Messier 7, it's 4 degrees. To Caos Australis, it's about 6. But if we go from Alnaso, where we were before at that spout, it's about 5 degrees. Shaula to Messier 7 is just a hair less than that at 4.5 or so in that particular direction. So you can kind of triangulate about where you're going to go. So you're going to sort of split the difference between those two stars and go about 5 degrees that way. The nice thing is that when we zoom in here using our finder scope view, and you know what, I need to actually back this off. There's our 7-degree field view. We have another star very close by that's going to serve almost as a pointer right to this. So if we follow, if we look at these two stars, Shaula is the brighter one. Lesath is the dimmer one at about magnitude 3. Shaula is 1.6, so definitely brighter. You'll see the difference. Kind of go in that direction. And you'll see, before you even lose Shaula on the other side, Messier 7 is going to come into your field view. So just keep going that direction. Right about the time that Shaula is going to leave your field of view, Messier 7 will be fairly close to centered. And trust me, you're not going to miss this cluster. It's very dense with stars. It's also large. So unless you're in a really, really light polluted area or your view is very hazy because you're looking so low to the horizon, you will probably be able to see this through your finder scope as long as you have a finder scope of 30 or 40 millimeters diameter for your main aperture of it or larger. Now, really the best way to view this is through binoculars because when we zoom in on this, here's our 1-degree field of view like we had with Messier 6. You can see how large this is. It just fills the field of view. So I can back this off some more and kind of bring out, this is almost a 3-degree field of view. That actually finely frames it. So if you have a very short focal length telescope with a really long focal length eyepiece that you can get two and a half or close to 3 degrees, that's going to be an ideal way to look at Messier 7 or use binoculars. Binoculars are really going to be maybe your best bet here. And it's low to the ground, so you can put them on a tripod if you've got the binocular bracket and look that direction. Just kind of settle in and let your eyes focus and you'll see quite a bit there. So that is all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.